Sportsmanship. The only missing piece is you. those numbers are times the board, so we'll do our best. Set to kick things off here in the first game of the girls round tonight.
Metal Pavlik is going to jump to the Tejeda. And we will be underway shortly here from Easy Canary.
Another board by Julie, but she throws it away. We've got drums on the break, Paul.
Yep, here come the Tigers. Up and she is fouled. Warner will go to the line to shoot a pair. .403 to go, no score yet.
We may have some varying styles. So talk to Coach Shimani before the game for Maple Manor. She was very cordial, very nice game here, starting lineups. I said, who's first off the bench? She looked at me, she said, Rich, I only got seven tonight. So I said, all right, best of luck. And there's the first points of the game. Kylie Warner. Pressure applied by the Tigers.
Collado with the ball. Over to Franchellis. Now back out to Flintosh. Left-handed dribbling in the corner. Now switches over to the right hand. 3:49 to go in the first quarter. Drums leads 1-0. Three ball on the way is short. And Flintosh runs down the loose ball. Inside to Tejeda, and she shuffled her feet there.
She did. She took a couple
of extra privileges. Obviously obvious what Maple Manor wants to do. They want to get the ball inside to Tejeda, and they have a huge size advantage over Drums.
They do.
Three ball on the way is no good. Jumper short, partially blocked.
Well, actually, Paul Pavlik's not short either. She matches up with Tejada very well for Drums.
A lot on the breakout, misses the layup. Flintosh can't get it to fall. Tejada still batted around. And they're going to call a jump ball here.
And it is going to go to the Tigers. 1-0. Halfway gone here to first quarter. And I think we're going to get a 30-second timeout. Paul Bow, what are we doing? We staying? We going?
Let's take a break. We'll be back to Hazel area. Here to Hazel area. Drums leading 1-0. Defensive game so far as Warner's going to go to the line to shoot again.
Correct. And we'll see if they caught him in the act of shooting. If she's going to get two, and she is.
Yeah.
I didn't know if they were initially going to call that on the floor. It was a little bit close, but they got her in the act of shooting.
And Kylie on the line. First one up, and first one is off the back iron.
Kylie has, I've noticed, a distinct method at the foul line. She really takes her time.
Yep. Good rotation. Just a little short on that one. Ball into the hands of Collada and over to Flintosh. Adriana, little house of fire there. She goes with that ball, Coach.
She does.
Left-handed dribble. Now back over to right hand. She can use both hands with the ball. Pass inside to Tejeda and slapped away again. And we're going to have a jump ball, and then it'll stay here with the Lady Vikings.
It will.
2:26 to go in the first quarter. Thanks for tuning in tonight. Spending your Tuesday night with us.
Crowd fighting in.
Yep, still coming in. Anthracite Middle School Playoffs. Girls up tonight. Boys we had last night. Thursday we'll have the championship. Tejeda backs her way in. And she'll go to the line to shoot a pair. With 2:23 to go in the first quarter.
Opportunity here for Julie to get on the board and to get Maple Manor on the board.
First one up, rims out. Second one is short. Lady Vikings still looking for their first points.
Yeah, Pavlok's taking it down to Pavlik down the court. All the way, some pretty impressive dribbling skills.
Yep, left wing now back into the corner. Bounce pass to Pavlik. Off the board in. Doesn't get it to fall. Lady Vikings looking to run. Trunkosko loses the ball. And we have another jump ball.
And this will go right back down to Drums, if the possession arrow is correct. The Vikings had a little bit of a break there, but couldn't convert.
Well, both teams are having problems, Coach, with the big court. It's obvious. They're having a lot of problems with the big court.
Well, you alluded to me last night. You mentioned that last night, but you know, as an outsider, you said the other courts, the facilities are much smaller.
Yeah,
than
Drums
this.
Is a smaller court. Now, Maple Manor right across the street, the old Bishop Hafey court, that's decent size, but nothing's as big as this. This is mammoth. Tejeda, she'll go back to the line again.
Her and Meadow Pavlik are going at it down there in a good competitive way, battling for boards.
You mean like a dentist and a carpenter? Tooth and nail?
Tooth and nail. Here's a new one.
You set it up for it.
I thought I'd get a break on Valentine's Day, but I'm
You don't
I'm
even
not.
Wear red.
I wore pink. Well, salmon.
First one, no good. Christian has red on. Substitutions in the game, Coach. You can have them.
I didn't even see. I was looking over at Christian when you said the red, to be honest with you.
We'll get them as they come down the court. Like I said, very hard to see the jerseys, the numbers for drums.
Here we go. It's good. We are tied.
No basket.
No basket. No. We are not tied. They get a lane violation, yep. Or was she over the line?
Yep. Over line.
I believe that was Kenzie Kistulens. Kistulens that threw that, had that little mishap. She's one that checked in for the Tigers.
Here comes Flintosh into Tejeda. Tejeda looking to distribute from the foul line. Jumper, no good. Ball batted around.
The interesting offensive set as they posted Tejeda out all the way to the foul line in that particular set. That's an over and back that they're going to call. Her feet weren't over, but the ball was, so apparently the rule must be the ball, because her feet definitely were not in the back court.
Well, no, it's your feet. Your feet are. It doesn't matter where the ball is.
Well, the feet were
she
definitely
said that he
not
pointed
over
to the line. I think he said he stepped on the line. Mabel Manor's going to call a timeout. 30-second timeout. We'll keep it right here, Coach.
Well, we've got some interesting people coming up. Paul, who we got at halftime first game tonight?
We got Kevin Yerkanen coming up. He helps run this league. Longtime friend of mine. Fellow Miami Dolphins fan.
You know what I'm noticing?
What's that?
The longer I meet people in this community through you, everybody's a longtime friend of yours.
Well,
which is a good thing. I don't mean that, you know, I mean it with much respect.
But Kevin's going to set us up for the main event. The second game. We got Coach Gavio coming on.
We do.
Now, halftime's only 15 minutes, so we're going to probably get one question out.
Here's something, Paul Bowe. Here we go.
Tejeda, little backdoor screen here. Jumper is no good.
And there's a travel. She took the steps before she bounced. Larimer Collado,
56 seconds to go in the quarter. That Flintosh again trying to run that down.
She's got great quickness.
Jumper banks it in.
Oh, turnaround right off the board for Peyton Albertson. 2 points for Drums. They extend their lead, Paul, with 40 seconds roughly left in this first quarter.
Yeah, Mabel Manor trying to get on the board here. They hate it. They're triple teaming her. Oh, and hard goes Flintosh into that stanchion there.
I like the way she plays.
Adriana hustles.
She's an energizer bunny. And
no, nobody would know who I'm talking about, Coach, besides you, but she reminds me of Piper Minier from South Williamsport.
Yes, she does.
A little firecracker like that.
You know who else she reminds me of?
Who's that?
Number four for the Lady Cougars.
Oh,
let's
see.
Lacey Kringy, with her effort and her tenacity, being around the ball.
You got a break there. That's Albertson again. Can't get the ball. Tejeda pulls another rebound. Mabel Manor looking to run.
Kistelins runs that down. Looks like the Vikings had a break.
And yes. 3 seconds to go.
I said Vikings. You want the story?
I've got the story before.
All right. You don't want the story.
We can tell the story in a timeout when there's a minute-long timeout. Flintosh, top of the key. Tejeda at the buzzer, and it will not count. One quarter in the books. Low scoring, defensive game. Drums leads 3-0. We'll take a break. We'll be back. Hi, we're back here. Coach, give us the Viking story.
It's all right. You already heard
it.
No,
I want to know it. I'm getting text messages. Coach, yeah. Tell us about the Vikings. That was Coach Mr. Z.
My first teaching opportunities with sixth graders, and they just, let's just say, great kids, but they didn't put G's on any of their words. So they were the Vikings for a long time as a sixth grade world culture teacher when I started, right after the Civil
War. Where was that up at? Troy?
Troy, Pennsylvania.
That's where they brought the horse, right?
That's not that Troy. Oh, you've said that before.
All right. Well, nobody else heard that one.
Oh, double dribble, I believe.
And it's going to be a turnover again here. 3-0. Good part for Maple Manor is they're still in the ball game.
Absolutely correct.
And if they can make some of their shots down low, Coach,
well,
they'll be tough. Tejeda is a tough to handle under there.
She is. She's had her chances with some shots if they start to fall.
And what they're doing, as you said, Coach, they're bringing someone up to post them in the high post there and looking to distribute left and right. That time, what number is that there? Number 3, Mrs. Troncosco. Mrs. Troncosco would have turned left. She had Tejeda underneath the basket.
And that's what they're doing, one of two things. Either they're posting Julie Tejeda down low and getting her the ball immediately. They're bringing her foul line extended and then letting her work off the initial pass. That time, as you said, they brought Troncosco out, kept Julie down low, and they just couldn't convert.
I would keep Julie on the block the whole night. Good defense there. Shot no good. And that's going to stay here.
Yeah, Fritz Romero did a nice job intercepting that pass, by the way. Paul picked that inbound pass off for the Tigers.
Fritz, number 11?
Yep.
Okay. Over to Warner. Warner drives baseline. Trying to get to Romero there. Hazard. Long pass, running it down is Warner again. 4:49 to go in the half.
Reset, they're extended.
Yeah.
And there comes Francellis, right? Excuse me.
Wysocki.
Adriana Flintosh right on there pressuring the ball and
forcing a turnover.
I told her before the game I was jealous of her bun. I wish I had enough hair. She just smiled. Great kids. Got her to meet her coach and Julie Tejeda before the game.
Picked off. It's going to be Maple Manor ball with 4:22 to go here in the half.
Vikings are hanging around. As you said, I think, you know, with the excitement of playing here on the big floor, and it's I think it's added a little bit to the shooting woes.
Here's a steal by Wysocki.
Yeah, and they're going to get a double dribble. It's going to negate the basket. Coach Kringy just turns and walks the other way calmly. Still walking, has a seat. And we have a travel and a turnover. And the ball is going to come right back to the 13-3 Drums Tigers. And I believe you mentioned at the start of the game, both teams with identical records, 13-3.
13-3. Drums will have the 2 seed, and Maple Manor is the 3 seed. Later on tonight in the nightcap, we will have Valley and West Hazlett, and Valley undefeated, 16-0. And last night we saw Freeland with 16 wins, got upset by Heights. 3-ball on the way is no good. Good hustle for the loose ball. Over to Albertson. Albertson over to Warner in the corner. Jumper is good.
Yeah, Kayla Wysocki.
And it's 5-0. I think the scoreboard froze, Coach. So you know who we're blaming.
You're blaming.
Pass. Tejeda nice down low.
Julie finally gets a chance to convert first points of the game for the Vikings.
And that was big.
It is. You don't want to get too far behind.
Jumper from the outside by Albertson, no good.
It's going to go back to Maple Manor. 3:10 left in this second quarter of the opening game. Paul Bow tonight doing his usual stellar job calling the game. Flintosh picks up her dribble, and
there it is. And they're going to get, I think they're going to travel there. Nope. 3 seconds.
Well, once again, then he had that Chancaso foul line extended, looking to deal off that entrance pass, but a 3 second call negated it.
Down to left wing.
In a hurry, but stolen by guess who?
Yeah, Flintosh.
She's off to the races, and
oh, missed the bunny. Couldn't get it to fall. Here comes the Tigers.
Look at her sprint right back. Look at the hustle from her.
Warner. Jumper, no good. Rebounded by Flintosh.
As she sprints down the floor, gets a rebound off the miss.
She's weaving her way in there and can't get it to fall. When that hit off the head of a Drums player, let's hope she's okay.
She's fine. And we get a timeout called by Coach Kringy. 30-second timeout.
Yeah, we'll take a break here from Hazel area. We'll be back. 2:23 to go in the half. 5-2 Tigers over Lady Vikings. Back to Hazel area. 5-2 Drums leads. Low scoring game, Coach.
Yep. And you have these things sometimes. There's defensive games in every sport.
Tablet. Back over to Albertson, now swings it across to Romero.
Stolen by Flintosh, and there she goes again on the break.
And she'll go to the line, finally being rewarded. Could have gone to the line to shoot two.
Foul is on Meadow Pavlik. That is her fourth.
She's got
on the line for Maple Manor.
Four fouls already.
Adriana Flintosh.
It is. Well, I think she'll be taking a seat for the last 2 minutes and 5 seconds of the first half. Well, let's see if Adriana can put both of these in.
First one up, first
wow,
one.
Wow, nothing but net.
Her shot is up and good.
Beautiful shot.
Kylie Warner entering the game for Drums. Francella Scalato entering the game for Maple Manor.
And there you go, as you heard the substitutions from the floor.
Second one is off the back iron. Tejeda gets the rebound, can't get it to fall. Colada has it blocked.
Troncoso had an opportunity to put it back up, but it was blocked.
Yeah, Troncoso, my mistake. Sorry, Coach.
That's all right. Back down the floor come the Tigers. Viking extending that defense out.
Yeah, into the corner, and that is nice move and a good block by Tejada, but
they're going to get her with the body. Other than that, it was a decent block. She didn't want anybody in the neighborhood.
No.
Foul is on Julie Tejada. That is her first on the line. Be Kayla Wysocki shooting two.
Wysocki on the line shooting two. 1:39 to go
Peyton
in the half.
Albertson shooting two.
It's Albertson.
Albertson.
Yep.
I was just listening to the PA announcer.
Oh, yeah. They corrected themselves. They've got a much closer look at those numbers than we do.
And they can't see them.
From Peyton's first shot
way
is up to good.
The top of McGeehan Gymnasium in our perch.
I can use my monitor tonight. That is no good. First one's good. Second one, no good. Drums comes down with the rebound. Long three.
Ooh.
Flintosh with the loose ball. Turns on the Jets. Taps the brakes. No good. Here comes Warner. And they're going to say on the floor there. Good call.
Yep.
6-3 with 1:16 to go.
Foul is on Francesca Collado. Her first.
Drum's looking inbound.
Ball stolen.
And there goes Miss Flintosh. Taking off. Tejeda again underneath. Can't get it to fall.
Yeah, I think Julie found herself just a little bit too far under the basket.
Yeah, a little bit too far.
However, the possession arrow is going to stay.
Jump ball possession will stay with Maple Leaf.
Vikings ball. 1:02 left.
Flintosh. The ball right-handed. Now behind her back she goes, switches over to the left.
She's being hounded by Warner. Right in, and there it is again, another board.
There you go, Tejeda gets it to go.
Julie Tejeda for two.
Give her five, I believe, Coach. Four.
She's got all the points, I believe.
Yep. Warner on the runner, no good. Tejeda on the break, looking to run. Up ahead to Collado. Up
what
ahead.
Pass, and we got two baskets within the last 20 seconds.
Maple Manor takes the lead with 20 seconds to go in the half. Pass to Romero. Romero from the foul line.
And that's going to be a double dribble walk. And out of nowhere, the Vikings have erupted with two big baskets to take a one-point lead. Do you play for one shot?
Yes.
All right. Hey, you don't know the way they're going up and down the court. We've got, I think Kaylee's going off the court. I don't know if she's hurt or not.
Entered the game for drums. She's holding her hand.
She's going right to the locker room. Let's hope she's okay. There's a pass to Flintosh here. 10 seconds to go. Across the timeline. 8 seconds. Behind her back she goes.
She's going to be fouled. She's going to be fouled by Kayla.
On Kayla Wysocki, her first.
Collado's going to inbound. See if they double Tejeda underneath. 5 seconds, 4 seconds, 3 seconds. They're not going to get a shot off here.
No, it'll be a. They got another 3 second call on Julie.
And it looks like we'll be at the half, Coach, 7-6.
We are.
Maple Manor shoots a zero in the first quarter, but they came back with seven in the second. We are at the half. It is 7-6. Don't go anywhere. We should have a halftime guest coming up. Not sure where he is if he comes up. If not, worst comes to worst, we'll get Brian Billing.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, now we will have the halftime shootout.
All right, we're back here at the half, and speaking of longtime friends, we got Kevin Yerkanen up in the booth tonight.
Ah, thanks, Paul. Good to see you again, as always, buddy.
Absolutely.
Longtime friends.
Yeah, we've been together a long time, and hey, what's your role in this? I know you said you help run the league with Kathy.
Yes, right now during the championships. During the regular season, it's the different schools, but then when we come to championship time, my role is the executive of getting trophies for the teams.
You are
the
Vince McMahon.
I am the Vince McMahon, right, I guess. That's what they tell me, but I'm not as rich as Vince McMahon, but, I guess I'll take the title.
Hey, but I was talking last night. We had Sarge on last night, and we were just talking about how this league has evolved back from when my son used to play, Jonathan, and I mean, he's 21 years old now, but how this league evolved and just the difference. Seeing this and seeing this crowd, what a beautiful facility here, and seeing everybody come together. It was like a college atmosphere last night. It really was.
It's awesome, isn't it? Every year it's awesome. I mean, besides doing what I do here for championship time, I coached when McAdoo put a team in when they had their middle school. I became their second coach. And it's just nice for the kids to get involved. The 7th, 8th grade league, they don't have to travel. Everybody's home in their backyard. It's a great league. It's a nice feeder system for the varsity programs here at Hazleton area. It's a fantastic league.
And that's what Rich and I were saying last night. I mean, you're getting kids from all over, and you're getting feeder systems, hopefully for Hazleton. But if not, you got Marion down there, and you got MMI, and just everybody taking looks. And last night with the boys game, I'll tell you what, Freeland, I know they lost the game, but when they came out on the court, Rich said to me, he goes, I thought the high school was doing drills.
How about it?
He said, I can't believe the size of them. But I'll tell you what, hats off to Heights. You talk about a scrappy bunch of kids that just fought and fought and fought. And they got some players on that team.
Oh, yeah. Unfortunately, I was under the weather last night, so I caught you guys during the live feed. And, what a game.
Great game. And this game here, more of a defensive game here. I said, Maple Manor, they got off to a slow start. But 7 points in the second quarter, they're trying to get the ball into Tejeda every single time under there. And I'll tell you what, as she develops through the system coming here, you can't teach height.
Never.
And she's got it. And
you can never teach height, and you can never penalize height, as I always tell the referees as the interpreter. You can never penalize height.
And unfortunately, the three of us here are vertically challenged.
We are vertically challenged. Absolutely correct.
But so going to this game here, what did you see going on there, Kevin?
Just a nice mix. It's a, like you said, a defensive battle. It's going to be a back and forth game. I'm kind of saying it's going to be down to who has the ball for the last possession and if they can make the shot.
Now you coach it, or you teach at Drums? I know that.
I do teach at Drums.
Okay.
Yes.
So here's my thing. We need to change those uniforms. I cannot see the numbers.
Oh, listen. We need to change the uniforms and the scoreboard at Drums, because you know what, Paulie? The scoreboard is as old as the building. It's been there since 2000 when I first started teaching there. It's the same board, and the uniforms are pretty much just the same that the kids had back in 2000.
Well, the bright side, if Drums wins and Valley wins, Drums will have their dark jerseys on.
I'll be able to see the numbers. There you go. Perfect.
We got one of these things up here, but it doesn't work.
There you go.
We're waiting to get it hooked up here. We're waiting for Damien to put his magic together to get my computer working there. But, you know,
if anybody can do it, Damien can.
You know, and I know you're still doing the broadcasting for Bloomsburg.
I'm the PA announcer for the Bloomsburg football program. Every now and then they have me come and do some men and women's basketball action too. So
that's great. Yeah. That's great. And some of the athletes that Rich knows down there, Nasir Jones from Williamsport.
Oh my goodness! Wow.
Saw him come through.
Sure.
Rich was the South Williamsport coach back in the day.
All right.
You know, so
yeah,
we saw a lot of those kids coming. There's a lot of them in Bloomsburg now, from Jersey Shore. I saw the one kid.
There are the Jersey Shore, Danville.
Yeah.
You know, Matt Bookman just signed with Bloomsburg.
He's going to Bloom.
So a lot of local flavor coming.
That's good.
You know, Coach Sheptaki has a young team, but you know, a lot of heart and
beautiful complex there.
Yeah, very nice complex. Yeah. New turf, about 2 or 3 years old only. It's a great place to play. You know, like I tell everybody, Division II football is just as good. It's spectacular. PSAC has some awesome teams. They have some great competition, great place, great conference to play in.
I know. I played in it.
There you go.
I actually had several collisions with Mr. Sheptaki.
Okay.
I played it. I was a running back for Lock Haven back in the day, and he was a linebacker for Bloom. So great guy. And then I coached against him when he was at Wilkes. I coached at Lycoming with Frank Girardi for a while, so just a wonderful guy. And then I don't know how long you've been at Bloom, but all the way back, I know Danny Hale very, very well.
I was a student when Danny Hale was.
Okay.
I was a student at Bloom when Danny Hale was the coach.
Yeah,
and
great
guy. He's the man, the myth, the legend, all rolled up into one.
Well, he is that, but I'll tell you what. He came from Bucknell, and Rocky Reese was on the same staff that Danny Hale was, and a lot of good guys there.
Oh, yeah.
But you hit it on the head with the PSAC, and it's good to see the local flavor there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I always said that when I looked at the rosters to say, hey, we need some guys around the area to come to these schools because, again, they're local, it's great competition.
And some of them are playing on Sundays.
Absolutely.
So,
yes, sir.
How about the Hazel area, the broadcasters they put out? Kevin Yerkanen, Paul Ball, come on. we got Coach and Coach is a Hazeltonian now, originally from Monoi City. We have him as a Hazeltonian now, honorary.
Perfect.
Since he does so many games.
That's all right. Monoi area, my wife's from Delano, Pennsylvania. So
wonderful.
I know the area very well.
I remember the Delano Death March.
There you go.
Well, Kev, we'll let you get back to your duties. Thanks for coming up.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Hey,
I appreciate it.
You're the warm-up. We got Coach Gavio coming on the second game.
Oh, well, then you might... Listen, one question might take him the whole interview.
That's what I said. Everybody's saying that.
So you may have to hold cue cards for him to say 15 seconds, 10 seconds.
Hey, we got about 7 minutes up. We'll see if we get Billy up here. I'll tell him to come up. We'll get him to...
There you go.
He's never short on words.
Never.
So, Kev, how long has this Anthracite League been in existence?
Oh, boy.
Is it something that's been a long time, or is it just recently?
Paul and I were in junior high school, we had the Anthracite League. That was the old D.A. Harmon, Freeland, Breeby, Rockland, West Hazleton,
Weatherly was in it.
We had that going on. And then it kind of transferred over to, it kind of sat dormant for a while because that's when Hazleton area came in and they kind of had all the different junior high, middle school programs. I think it's been 23 years now. 2000, I think, once Drums opened up, they brought all those middle schools and said, hey, let's have our own league rather than, traveling up to Wilkes-Barre, a seventh grade team. And I think they only did like a seventh grade league only on Saturdays. Eighth grade maybe moved up. I think they actually played in the freshman level. So we decided, hey, those eighth graders, they're not going to play freshmen. Let's bring a seventh and eighth grade league back together again. And we'll mesh the schools together. And as we added schools in the Hazleton area school district, we have 10 middle schools already, plus, Holy Family.
Yeah.
MMI has some teams. So we got a nice 12-team, local league.
It's,
you don't have to travel. You don't have to go far. Parents don't have to worry about getting their children on a bus and traveling and waiting there. They could come to every game. That's a nice thing.
But this, just to look out here and see all the families here. I mean, this just... Coach and I do some basketball games down in Central, but they don't even draw half of these many people for high school basketball. And then last night's crowd here, I mean,
right.
Hazel area's been drawn pretty good, but I mean, this crowd was probably the biggest crowd of the year.
And again,
it's really great to see.
And I think, Paul, again, because of that local flavor, that everybody's right in town, it's a couple minutes to drive up to the high school to see your son or daughter play 7th and 8th grade basketball. It's a fantastic league.
And a beautiful facility here.
Absolutely.
First class.
Yes, sir.
Rich said yesterday when who was it walking in? Was Hazleton kids walking in?
Hazleton came in.
He said they were walking in, their eyes were so big because they were coming into the big house here.
I mean, this is the first time I've seen the scoreboard, but
beautiful.
If I was a 7th or 8th grade kid walking on the floor for the first time, it's like, holy cow, this is unbelievable. And unfortunately, maybe for some of those 8th graders, they may not play again next year. This might be their only time to see what this is like on the court, and it's such a great experience for them. That memory will last them for a lifetime.
That's still
fantastic.
Remember playing at the Castle in the Ernie Vallette League, dribbling the ball, and you'd hit the dead spots on the floor, and the ball would just go dead.
There you go.
Right underneath the basement.
Right.
There,
so. And like when I played at Harmon, that was the big thing when we played Greeby. We played at the high school gym, so that was... That was great.
Yep, down in the pit in Harmon. That's where it was.
There you go.
Gav was the coach, right?
Yes, he was.
Yep. He was coaching all the way back then, Rich.
We were
in Harmon.
In Harmon.
Wow.
D.A. Harmon.
Yep.
Hey, it's in their blood.
Absolutely.
So,
all right, Paul.
Good to see you.
Rich, thank you very much. Nice to meet you. Take care, everybody. Thanks, guys.
All right. Kevin, your cannon, our Vince McMahon for the couple days. With the trophy presentations, always great to see Kev. Great guy. Longtime friend, know him a long time. And just really good people up here. And like I said, they did a great job with this league.
Hey. I'm going to stop saying it because I say it every broadcast. You know how I feel about the people you've introduced me here to and the people I've met. Chubby told me tonight that I can call him Chubby. He wants me to call him Chubby. And he said, he gave me the story behind it. But he also, you know, had a lot of nice things to say about you. And you can see the...
Chubby was my gym teacher, I told you that.
Yep, you can see the in tightness.
In like kindergarten. That's how old he is. But he still looks good. And Chubby, hey, Chubby was, we kid around with him all the time. He's a great guy. You're talking about a good athlete.
Yeah.
Wow, one of the best.
You had mentioned that.
Yep, one of the best and a great guy. And like I said, it's, let's get back to the game here, Coach. 7-6.
Yep, an offensive onslaught late by the Vikings.
Well, for Alyssa Shimhany's Vikings, I think, we're going to do the keys to the game because we haven't done this a little bit. And that's my fault because I slipped up. I'm going to take the Vikings. And I'm going to say the dribble drive penetration by Flintosh, getting the ball into Tejada, whatever you want to call it, and getting good looks at the basket. I mean, that's the key for Maple Manor. They won 13 games. Same thing with Drums. These are mirror images teams. Drums is just a lot quicker with the guards. They don't have the size. Four fouls for Meadow Pavlik for Drums to continue, Coach, what they did in the first quarter. What do they got to do?
Well, I think they've got to keep running and pushing the pace because there aren't very many Vikings left in the war boat. You know,
absolutely.
There's only seven total on the bench, so maybe see if they tire out the second half. And because you've got two totally different offenses going at it here, as you so eloquently stated. Maple Manor wants to get that ball either foul line extended high to Julie or down low, and you know Drums is more of a run and gun team, and I think offensively they get what they can, so we'll see if they can beat the Vikings up and down the court in the second half and get a couple of baskets and win the game.
Yep, and then the winner will play the winner of Valley and West Hazleton tonight. Valley girls coming in 16-0, and people still filtering into the gym here, as we were saying, Coach. And we got 12 minutes to decide this one. Who's going to the girls' championship? Girls' championship will be the 7 o'clock game on Thursday. Boys will tip it off with Heights and Valley. And we'll have ourselves a fun Thursday night.
Looking forward to it already. On this and I always call it Valentine's.
I saw
the M in there on
today,
purpose.
Yep.
That's an inside joke. You're not going to hear that one as we start the third quarter.
Sounds good to me. I have a jumper mid-range. Can't give the fall to hit another rebound. Aaron pass, 3-on-1 for the Tigers. Pavlik has it blocked. That is Pavlik in the game, Coach, correct, with the four fouls?
Yep, and they're going to get Larimer Collado with the foul, number 10. You are correct from what I can see. And
I apologize to everyone. I just could not see these numbers at all.
They have to be facing you.
Yep.
They have to be facing you a certain way to be able to see the numbers. So it's rare this day and age when you have a number which is soft as a color as a yellow.
It's not outlined.
That's not outlined.
Right. First one no good by Pavlik.
So they are what we call in the business not BF. They are not broadcaster friendly.
Either are my eyes sometimes. Pavlik got the line, and game is tied at 7.
Here we go. Meadow puts one of two in.
Meadow 4 points.
Now I've got a little bit of a defensive adjustment now as Kylie Warner is going to shadow.
1 point, excuse me. I read the wrong thing on her. My fault.
She's shadowing Adriana everywhere she goes.
Collado can't get the fall, and Meadow took it right over the back of Tejada. Up and lays it in.
Good hustle. Good hustle by Julie to get back down the floor, but she just beat her to it. And
now Meadow has 3 points.
Yep. And we have a turnover.
And Drums is going to put that pressure on. A lot of pushing going on down the other end there. Up and under and gets it to fall.
Meadows having herself a great start to the third quarter. Her and Julie are battling out under the boards.
Give her five now.
See, this is a good adjustment by Coach Kringy there, not allowing Adriana Flintosh to get anywhere near the basketball. They're making it hard for her.
Tejada strong to the hole and in.
Forcing somebody else to take care of the basketball. So far, with the exception of that shot, it's paid dividends for the Tigers.
Julie lays it up and in. And
6 points, I believe, for the young lady.
Yes. And the other, Flintosh has the other five, I believe. Three. And no good. All down by Pavlik. Meadow on the breakout. Taps the brakes. Turnaround jumper. No good. Looked good from up here.
It did initially.
And it's going to be out, and it's going to be Maple Manor's ball. Colado will inbound. Colado to La Colado. Sounds like a law firm there, Coach.
Yep. And we have an
offensive foul now. And that's going to be on, I think, Cajada, Tejada.
Moving screen, possibly.
That's going to be her second. Are you surprised they're not posting her up and going at Pavlik with four fouls? I am.
Yeah.
Pavlik from the elbow. Can't get it to fall. Tejada, just so tall, just grabs it right over the other girls.
She almost walked there.
Coach Kringy not happy at all about that, but turns it over. Drums with a 2-on-1.
But I can't stress enough how the defensive adjustment by Coach Kringy of keeping Flintosh from getting the offense started has thrown Maple Manor off.
Yeah. Pavlik again from just inside the elbow. Can't get it to fall. Tejada gets another loose ball. Across the timeline. Picks up her dribble. Jump ball, and it's going to be Maple Manor's ball with 3:34 to go.
But you can see how Maple Manor's disheveled because Flintosh can't get the ball. She can't quarterback.
They've been denying her the ball. There's a nice turnaround jumper. Is short.
That's the first time she's touched it in the second half.
Tejada can't get it to fall. Run down again by Colada. Tejada up. No good again. Pavlik another rebound. .311 to go. And no end for the steal. It was Troncoso. Good straight up block by Tejada there.
Yeah, she did a nice job staying straight up and down and put her arm straight up and down, which prevented her from getting the foul inside.
Ball tipped around again.
And that's going to be a double dribble up and down, if you will. Ball's going to be turned over to the Vikings. Trailing 11-9 here with 2:55 left to go in the third quarter. At McGeehan Gymnasium, another nice crowd on hand tonight.
Yeah, they keep filing in the doors here. Picks it up, inside, tries to get to Tejada. Can't. Pavlik comes down with the loose ball. Drums has a 3-on-2. Meadow running it coast to coast. Can't get it to fall. Albertson misses the shot. Tejada pulls the rebound down again.
A physical rebound by Julie. Yeah.
Tries to get it inside, but denied again.
Yeah, Troncoso was awaiting that pass, but it was a little bit too high and a little bit too soft.
2:14 to go. Jumper is no good. And we got an official's timeout. Yeah, shoelace open on the court.
Well, I think they're going to give a charge timeout to Coach Shimani.
Full timeout. We're going to take a break. We'll be back here to Hazelden area. Here, coach, 2 minutes, 4 seconds to go in the third quarter, 11-9, Drums leading. The Valley Eagle cheerleaders are right in front of his coach, just coming in.
Getting ready to leave their nest.
Into the corner. Stolen away, Pavlik on the breakout. Can't get the fall. You're right, though. Flintosh has not touched the ball, coach, at all in this third quarter.
Nope.
I'm really shocked because they're really not doing anything to prevent her from getting the ball.
Right. They're not setting any screens or anything like that to get her open. So, and I think it's completely discombobulated what Maple Manor has tried to do the first half, at least. So, great coaching adjustment, in my opinion. And again, you know, Maple Manor's got to, you know, only has seven available players, two on the bench. A little bit short in the first free throw. I think, you know, obviously this last minute 34 is going to be crucial because Maple Manor, I don't think, can afford to fall behind by more than two possessions.
Second one is no good. Flintosh gets the rebound. Dana just went the other way. I thought she was going to grab the rebound.
Yeah. And Kayla Warner's done a nice job harassing her the second half.
Yes, she did. Nice pass down low, partially tipped, and it will stay here.
Yeah, Troncoso had a shot.
.120 to go here in the third quarter. Tejeda off the board, up and in.
That was easy.
Nothing you can do about that.
Nope.
She got position.
Now we're down to a one-point game as we're coming down to the end of the third quarter.
No, we're tied, coach. We're tied at 11.
We're tied, and we have a turnover as Maple Manor slaps on the press. You're right. I apologize.
No, you were right, though, about Maple Manor. They can't afford to get behind by two. They have a very slow, methodical offense. It's centered around number 30 and number 5. They want to get the ball in down low. And you see when they do, they just can't deny her at all.
I'm seeing they're just forcing turnovers here the whole second half.
59 seconds to go. Pavlik gets the ball back out to Warner. Warner fends off a defender from the elbow. Running one-handers in.
Big shot.
Yes, nice shot by Kaylee. I'm sorry.
That was tipped, I think.
I thought it was tipped also.
Nope.
Scrum's ball with 36 seconds to go. Over to the right wing there. There's Wysocki in the corner, and she is fouled.
I believe we're going to get Emily Troncoso with that foul.
Excuse me, that's Albertson. That got fouled, 25.
We have a timeout?
Yep, 30-second timeout here by Drums. We'll keep it right here for the final 25 seconds, coach.
Sounds good to me. crowd still filing in.
Yeah.
A little bit slower, but they're still coming in. So we've got an undefeated team coming up in our nightcap, correct?
Drums looks the inbound, and they do to Pavlik. Pavlik fadeaway jumper, no good. Rebound by Tejeda again. 21 seconds to go. And Maple Manor's going to turn it over again.
And Julie sort of picked up her dribble there, and I don't know why. She didn't really need to. She had some open space.
I think she was looking up court and kind of
got caught betwixt and between.
Pavlik jumper is partially blocked into the hands of Tejeda again. 13 seconds. If they hurry, they can get a shot here. 10 seconds. Tejeda inside. Pass to... No good. 3 seconds. It'll stay here. See if they try to free up Flintosh here.
Well, I don't know. I want to see if they go back to that inbound
or
to play
Tejeda.
To Tejeda.
That's what I would do. Throw it high. There it is. At the buzzer.
Nope.
All right. Three quarters in the books, Coach. Drums 13 and Maple Manor 11. We'll take a quick break. Hopefully, Baby Shark's on soon. And we'll be back for the fourth quarter. Welcome back here. Fourth quarter just underway. Pavlik now just inside the three-point line. No good. And rebounded, throws way up to Tejada. Tejeda. Here comes Julie. Can't get it to fall. And good rebound there by Drums. Warner on the breakout. Picks up her dribble.
And you got a travel there, extended travel. Paul's going to go back to the Vikings.
Shout out to my mother-in-law listening, Coach. She just gave us her stamp of approval, as always. That means a lot.
Ill-advised three-point shot. And let's see if... if those legs now start to get a little bit tired for the Lady Vikings as they've been...
Well, don't forget, like I said, seven players, that's it.
Right, and they haven't been substituting much.
No, but key to the second half, Adriana Flintosh has really, really not touched the ball. She was the spark for Maple Manor. They got to find a way to get her the ball. Warner.
Well, she did a great job distributing and being the, you know, the quarterback of the offense, if you will.
Tejeda runs up, and that's going to be a travel, no basket.
She took it coast to coast and wasn't able to put it in, and now more reinforcements into the game. Nunez is going to go out for Drums Tigers.
I think Jenna Chulock checking in. Number one. And she stepped on the line. That's going to be a turnover.
Franchella Scalato did a nice job defending there, denying and forcing the turnover.
4:53 to go here. Lob it up is what I would do, Coach.
And they did, and there it is again. She just missed
the bunny, and good defense there by Drums on the breakaway. Look at Flintosh closing.
That should be back the other way. Ooh, I thought that might have gone.
Well, how quick is
to Maple Manor? Boy, she makes up a lot of room. I hope she runs track.
Yeah, she's quick.
Very.
Pavlik, she's had herself a nice game, blocked by Tejeda.
She has. You can see the two bigs down low going at it in a competitive way the entire game.
Yeah,
there's
absolutely.
No nonsense.
Mid-range jumper, no good, a little too far. The ball comes right back to Chulock there. Swings it over, tries to get inside to Pavlik. And they're going to get Tejeda with the blocking foul. And that's going to be three on her.
Yeah, but at this point, well, Coach Shimani is going to make a substitution. And Julie's going to come out. That's four on her, actually, Bob. So they certainly can't afford to lose her. However, there's only 4:29 left. First shot from Pavlik rolls in and out.
13-11 with 4:29 to go.
Coach giving some instructions to Julie on the bench.
And gets the second one. Three-point lead, and Maple Manor going with a much quicker lineup now.
Well, I can't imagine Julie being out.
No, she won't be out
for real long.
She might have got poked in the eye, Coach, because she keeps rubbing her eyes on the bench there.
Big steal.
Around the arc, three ball on the way by Warner. No good. Chulock with the rebound. Knocks it down.
That
was Warner. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Warner hit it. That's a big basket, even though it's a five-point lead. Good timeout by Alyssa Shimani. Might be a little bit too much for Maple Manor to overcome.
Yeah, five-point lead with 4 minutes to go. And Maple Manor hasn't scored this quarter yet.
Nope.
First 1:59 in.
You know, normally you would think with 4 minutes left, that's plenty of time to erase a five-point deficit, but Maple Manor has been greatly challenged offensively here, as you've stated.
Well, we got 4 minutes to decide who's going to be the first team in the girls' championship. Right now, the Drums Tigers were back. Left-handed dribble over to the right hand. Bounce pass. Baseline. Trancosco. Can't get it to fall, throws it over. Still batted around like a pinball in there. Into the hands of Flintosh. 3 minutes and 40 seconds to go.
Yeah, we're going to get a denial foul on Kayla Wysocki. I believe they got her with the body.
It's only the second team foul on Drums. 3:34 to go. In the ball game.
Stolen away goes Wysocki, I believe, again. A little bit too hard.
Yeah, Maple Manor has numbers. Up and can't get it to fall. There's a lid on that basket, Coach.
It is right now, and that hit every part of the rim.
Pavlik. With the breakout, 3 minutes and 10 seconds to go here. Mid-range jumper is short. Warner gets the ball, passes over, a little short underneath again. Pavlik, and she gets it to fall.
and that might be it now. With Julie on the bench, they have a major, major height advantage with Meadow underneath, and they just took advantage of it.
Full timeout here by Drums. Good timeout by Coach Kringer. 18-11. Let's take a break. Final one of the night. We'll be back. Welcome back. 2:53 to go in the ballgame. A 7-point lead for Drums. And Meadow will be at the line. Trying to complete the 3-point play, Coach.
Yes, sir. Add to her team leading 8 points. And she's done a nice job managing her 4 fouls because she's had them for quite a while. She puts in her 9th point of the evening. Drums up by 8 with 2:45 left to go in this basketball game. Timeout by Coach Shimani as Maple Manor was having issues getting the ball. And Paul, again, we're looking at the scoreboard. I'm wondering if Julie fouled out and they only have her listed at 4 fouls.
She might have, yeah.
Because I can't believe Coach Shimani wouldn't have her back in the game. Well, just as I open my mouth, guess who gets up to come over to the scorer's table?
I think she might have got poked in the eye. She was holding her eyes on the bench. Ron kept rubbing her eyes on the bench.
Well, I think it's pretty clear what they've got to do.
Huh, yeah. And they're down by 8.
And do it fairly quickly. Timeout situation. Maple Manor has 1 Drums with 1 remaining as well. The Vikings are going to have to maximize their possessions.
Side Tejada pulls the rebound down, puts it up, gets in the fall.
And Wright immediately makes her presence felt.
Yeah, lead down to 6. I'm surprised they're not pressing. I really am.
Paul, I don't know how much they have left.
Well, it's 2:17.
You're right.
You got to try to see what you can do here. You only got so much time left in your season.
Now there's a turnover
by Flintosh.
Right in, looking for Julie.
And there's 5 on Meadow, I believe.
Yep.
I think she's going to foul out.
You think they've got her?
I think she was denied her. Let's see who they called it on. I hope not for the young lady's sake, but let's see.
It is not on her.
No.
Well, your Maple Manor... perfect. You got a chance to chip away at the lead, and the clock has stopped. And that was close to being almost a 3-point play here.
Yeah. Young lady, you got to take your time, bend your knees, get some good rotation on the ball, and follow through. Take your time. There you go. Much better there. Much better there. Just couldn't get the roll there. Pavlik calls the boards, 1:58 to go. Pavlik, the ball back over. Backs it out. Over to Warner. Warner's been dynamite tonight. She really has. She did a great job defensively.
Correct.
1:34 to go. Maple Manor, a lot of them standing flat-footed, Coach. I think you're right.
They've been going the whole game.
Yeah, there's not much left in the tank.
Smart move by Meadow there, understanding where we're at in the game.
Got a good look there. Couldn't get down, and Warner runs it down. 1:10 to go. 6-point lead.
And they're spreading the floor now. They're going to make Maple Manor come out and foul them, or they've gotten away with the travel there.
Yeah, Flintosh trying to swat at it. We're under a minute to play here. They got to foul quick. Coach Shabani screaming down there for them to foul.
Nice job by Drums playing keep away here
for a good minute. At least.
Maybe an ill-advised shot there, I would
think. They took two shots and they keep getting the rebounds. Maple Manor just looks out of gas.
I think they are, Paul. These kids have played hard.
Yeah, they played hard. They played a good game, and we're going to get a foul finally with 24 seconds to go.
Correct. It's just not going to be enough. And that's going to be it, I believe, for Julie Tejeda, which she's coming out of the game. She's got a bright future. What do you think there?
Oh, absolutely. Just got to work a little bit on footwork and, you know, knowing it. She has, we talked with Kevin, she has the height. You can't teach the height. And
boy, if her and Meadow Pavlik end up on the same team.
You know, and you got to remember, these girls are in 7th and 8th grade.
Correct.
They're not done growing yet.
No.
You know, and same thing with the boys we saw yesterday.
But you see a lot with the girls here, even though they're more mature cerebrally, maybe not as much so athletically. So that's a very good point by you. They're still going to grow into their bodies and get all those, you know, techniques and fundamentals down as they progress through the system. But boy, they can be something in a couple years. You agree with that?
I do. Well,
yeah.
I do. I mean,
wow.
Yeah, I mean, you got some talent.
And you got Adriana Flintosh, who's just, she hasn't stopped.
She reminds me of Danielle Rennell from Pittston area.
Yep.
One of the motors that don't stop, nope. And you just keep going. But we're gonna get our player to game. We sent Christian down there already.
He's already down.
And she looks like our player of the game is at the foul line. I don't know if she's getting out of the foul line there.
I think we all know who it's going to be.
Yeah.
Leading her team with 9 points. Second leading scorer in the game. Julie's had 10. That was a 1-1.
Yes,
and nobody moved from Maple Manor. And that's pretty much going to do it. As the Tigers are going to run out the clock, and Paul, they will advance to the championship game with a 19-13 victory.
Well, the first quarter and the fourth quarter for Maple Manor was not kind.
I believe one point in the fourth quarter?
Two
points in the fourth quarter?
Yep, they had 11. Finished up 19-13. And they took the score down. I wanted to try to jot the numbers down for... Well, we know Meadow had 9, correct, or 10?
She had 9.
We know she had 9. Just trying to get some stuff ahead for Thursday's games. And Drum celebrating, and hey, rightfully so, but Maple Manor nothing to hang their heads on. A 13-4 season now comes to an end. And Coach Shabani, they're just out, man. They had 7 players on the team. You know what
only,
I mean?
Yeah, and you can only do so much.
Yeah, and but take nothing away from Drums. Drums is a scrappy team. They're quick. They got some size. They're well coached. And like I said, they'll take their chances in the championship game. We're here. We got our player of the game, Meadow Pavlik, 9 points. Congratulations on going to the championship game.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit out there. Looked very physical out there.
Yeah. I just want to thank my coaches for helping us get where we are. We wouldn't be here without them. And I'm very excited to be in the championship.
Yeah, now take me through a little bit of the first half. 4 fouls.
Yeah.
You're on the bench. We know how important you are to the team.
Yeah.
What is Coach Kringy saying to you?
She's telling me, like, don't foul. Like, don't get frustrated. Focus. Keep your head together. Hands up if once I get back in.
Yeah. I are you surprised that they didn't come at you when you had 4 fouls?
Yeah, I'm surprised they didn't foul me at that one point when I thought I fouled and they called it on my teammate.
Yeah. But, hey, that's a credit to you. That's a credit to your coaching staff. A credit to your teammates. You guys played. It wasn't the prettiest game, but you know what? What they say, a win's a win. It doesn't matter. You guys are going to the championship game. But you played a really nice game. You play a real nice game in the post. You could run the court, obviously, we see.
Yeah.
You're in eighth grade?
Yes.
Eighth grade. So where are you going to school next year?
I'm
going
to go to the high school.
Oh, and Coach Gavio will be happy, sure, yeah, to see you coming up there. We were just talking about the program, on what a feeder program it is for the schools. And you guys got so much talent, seventh and eighth grade coming up. But congratulations. And Coach?
Well, I'm just curious because it's such a big area and such a big school district. Do you know Julie Tejada by any chance at all?
No, I
do. Other than playing against her? Because you two had an awesome battle going on the entire game as the two bigs under the basket. So I like your intensity, but I also like the way you run the court. Your dribbling skills are outstanding. Did Coach make any adjustment at halftime to try and limit Adriana from running the offense for Maple Manor? Because by my calculation, she only literally touched the ball twice in the fourth quarter.
Yeah,
we were just trying to do that the entire game. It just wasn't working in the first half, and we realized she wasn't handling the ball very well, and we decided just to get on her face-to-face and see what happens.
All right.
So, Meadow, do you play any other sports? Or?
I play field hockey.
Excellent. Good for you, and I'm sure you're a top-notch student on top of it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's get a picture for our Facebook page of you as the player of the game. You can keep your headset on.
Okay.
It don't matter.
Okay.
We'll get you there. You want to stand? Where are you standing, Coach? All right. I'll stand on the left side here. All right. We'll get it up on the Hazelden page. All right. Congratulations.
Thank
and
you.
Best of luck on Thursday night.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
All right, Megan. Congrats. We'll be here. Yeah. Meadow, we'll be here. Congratulations. See ya. Nice young lady, as
yeah,
we all are.
Very well spoken. Eighth grader, and Coach, we talked about
an eighth grader.
Where are they coming? She's going into high school.
Well,
so how about this team coming up for Hazelden area next year on the girls? They're young to begin with. They get someone like Meadow, like I said, size. She has all the tools they could work with her. And you know, you
like,
think she's coming recommended by Coach Kringy?
Wow, and I'd like to find out if Julie Tejada and Adriana Flintosh also are going to be heading up to the high school, if they are indeed eighth graders as well, because I'll tell you what, you know, let's be honest, it was a little rough offensively at times tonight, but something that wasn't rough was the effort and, you know, the athletic skills and ability to watch these young ladies, how they run, and some of their mechanics are fine. They're going to get better as they develop physically. So,
yeah,
future looks pretty bright, I would think.
A 19-13 win for Drums. They'll take it. Valley and West Hazelden here coming up in about 8 minutes there. We got Coach. So Let's wrap it up from here. We'll take a little break. We'll take a deep breath. We'll get the starting lineups, and we'll be back with some basketball. Who's going to play drums? It's going to be the undefeated Eagles, or will it be the Wildcats of West Hazleton? All right, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, the nightcap here. The Valley Eagles come in unblemished, 16 wins, no losses, taking on the West Hazleton Wildcats at 9-7. Hello, everybody. My name is Paul Bowe, alongside my tag team partner as we finish up game number four here in two nights and three quarters of the championship field is set, Coach, and we'll see who will be punching their ticket on the girls' side.
That we will, Paul. We're seeing an impressive Valley Eagles team. We've got to assume that 16-0 take the court, correct?
Yep. And we are just about set for the introductions.
And Marie Cringer. And now the starting lineups for the Lady Eagles of Valley. Number four, Lauren Harmonsky. Number 10, Paige Harmon. Number 11, Alexis Staffen. Number 24, Leah Myers. And number 25, Olivia Martini. Valley is coached by Mr. Sean Malone. Your officials this evening, Mr. Chad Obert, Mr. Frank Brynock, and Mr. Joe Halasak. Ladies and gentlemen, we already played the national anthem prior to the first game, so there will not be a national anthem.
All right, we're sending it underway. We had the national anthem. It's going to be down to business, Coach.
Absolutely. Let's get it on to see who's going to be playing in the championship game on Thursday.
Alexis Staffen will jump. And for the Wildcats, it's going to be Amanda Capone. One seed versus the four seed, Coach.
Yep.
We saw what happened last night.
Beat me to the punch, Paul, Bo. We think alike too much.
We do. We have a special halftime guest tonight, Coach Gavio, coming on. So we are ready. Eagles control the tip and up and in goes Olivia Martini.
That's right. Olivia Martini with the basket.
Here come the Wildcats. Inside, a little too hot to handle, off the hands of Capone. And a turnover. And Valley, much like Drums, three really good guards and they like to get the ball inside.
Correct. And they didn't waste any time.
Staffen with the ball, now back out to Martini. Martini swings it over to Harmonosky. In the lane, up and in, goes
Leah Myers for two.
Two possessions, two baskets for the Lady Eagles.
Two baskets right in the paint. First 2 minutes of this game is definitely crucial for the Wildcats, and there's a turnover there. Into the hands of Harmonosky, right back over to Beltre. And now Beltre gives it to Toro. Toro's the scoring threat here for West Hazleton. She could fill it up from the outside. And over to Beltre. Beltre picks up her dribble, and they're going to get a jump ball, and it will stay here.
Jump ball,
with the Wildcats.
Arrow,
1 minute into the game,
West Hazleton.
And Valley not wasting any time, Coach, going right inside.
Correct, and it's very apparent that they are aggressive.
Santana looks to trigger the inbound over to Toro. Toro, right-handed dribble, running in the lane, and a rebound by Myers. Here comes Leah. Up ahead, good pass to Harmonowski off the window. A little too hard, missed the bunny. Back out again. Three ball on the way is no good. Another rebound by Staffen and pulled down by the Wildcats. Here comes Beltre. Beltre picks up her dribble, in trouble. Pass intercepted by Harmonowski. About three quarters court, and they're going to get a kick. And it's going to be West Hazleton ball. No, it's going to be Valley ball, as they're going to trigger the inbound is Alexis Staffen. And over to Harmon. Harmon across the timeline. Back over to Paige. Inside, Martini, and she is fouled. And it's no secret what the Lady Eagles want to do, Coach. They want to pound the ball inside.
Absolutely correct, as they've done it on at least half of their possessions early on in the first period. Martini already has a basket. She's going to go at the line to see if she can add on to her 2 points this evening.
First one up, first one good.
Nothing but net for Leah.
Five nothing Valley leads. Off the back of the iron and rebounded by Myers. Throws it up, can't get it to fall. And it's going to be West Hazleton ball.
So Wildcats coming in tonight at 9-7 obviously have an uphill struggle. As we saw last night, anything can happen.
Overhead to Beltre. Beltre taps the brakes, picks up her dribble, and another jump ball, and it's going to be Valley basketball.
I believe Leah Myers got her hands in there, tied it up, and possession arrow heading the Eagles' way.
Inside, Myers and Chill knock it down and go to the line.
Yeah, their inside game is.
Although every point
problem.
is on the block. Yep. Every single point for Valley. And there's a reason why they're 16-0, Coach.
Well, they look and appear to be well coached. They also look to have a set offensive philosophy, and they know what they want to do with the basketball when they have it.
And that's hard off the back. Gets her own rebound. And they're going to call another jump ball. And this time, it is going to be West Hazleton ball with 3:45 to go here in the first quarter. 7-0 Valley. And Toro jogs it up the court. Right-handed dribble all the way. Right wing.
Another jump ball. Paul, correct me if I'm wrong here, and I very well might be. Has West Hazleton had more than one shot opportunity even? I think that's all they've gotten so far. We're midway through the first period, so they even haven't even had a chance to put the ball in the basket.
Well, they just switched down to a 2-3 zone. They're going to try to pack it down low. There's a poke there. Into the hands of Staffen. Staffen back over to Myers. Myers, long pass over to Martini off her fingertips.
Yeah, great idea, she just couldn't handle it.
And West Hazleton, the first 5 minutes of this quarter, looks like they're struggling with the much bigger court.
And they are.
Toro, right-handed dribble, now crosses over from the foul line, jumper off the back of the tin.
One and done when they do get a shot.
Rebound by Staffen. Staffen over to Myers. Myers across the timeline. Over to Harmonowski. Now back over to Myers. Trump drive stops on a dime. A lot of contact. And Beltre with the rebound.
No physical basketball under the boards. Officials letting them play, which is fine.
Beltre pass inside. And that is going to be a turnover there. It's going to be Valley ball. And off the hands of Santizo. And Stafford triggers the inbound. Now over to Harmonoski. Here comes Lauren. Up the court, right-handed dribble over to the left, back to the right hand, cross the timeline. 2:20 to go. Bounce pass over to Pavlik. Back over to Gia, drives baseline, taps the brakes, back over to Myers. Myers running one-hander, baseline jumper, good.
Another basket, give her 6 points on the evening. To lead all scorers, the first quarter, and West Hazleton finding themselves a little bit deeper in the hole. As we get closer to the end of this first stanza, and a steal.
There's a turnover. Harmonoski, Lauren driving to the basket. She is fouled. And she'll go to the line to shoot a pair with 1:45 to go. A lot of celebrities in the crowd tonight, Coach. I can see. How about if you look directly across from us? Midge and Chubby together in the bleachers. See that, Bobby? Midge and Chubby together over there. All the way over. That's beautiful. That's a portrait. I like to hang that on my wall.
Only you can come up with that and notice that while calling a game and doing a nice job calling the game, mind you, at that and still able to locate
Midge and Chubby.
Midge and Chubby.
1:45 to go in the first quarter. 10-0 Valley. They've been absolutely dynamite so far in this first quarter.
And I mean only you, Paul Bowe.
Toro, off the bounce. I'll take a copy of that. Picks up her dribble. And they're going to have another jump ball here. It's going to be West Hazleton ball with 1:35 to go in the first quarter.
West Hazleton, and if you're watching the game, obviously, at home, is having all sorts of issues just even getting shots.
Yeah, Valley's quick, and they're in the zone. They're not even playing man. Up ahead to Pavlik. Tripped up at the foul line. No call. We play on. Into the hands of Beltre. Beltre, long cross-court pass. Up ahead to Santana, and she traveled, and
she
it'll be another turnover here. We don't have our stat guy, Christian, this game. He had to leave, so we'll be winging our stats. Well, he didn't leave yet. He's leaving soon. He has basketball practice.
Does a fine job.
He does.
Glad we were able to pick
him
up.
Oh, nice shot by Harmonoski. Nothing Valley. Toro. Just smothering defense there. Toro, jumper off the back iron, no good. And they're going to get a foul here. I think it's going to be on Pavlik.
I believe you're correct. Giada putting her hands where they shouldn't have been.
And West Hazleton will inbound with 36 seconds to go. Beltre with the ball, Toro. Long jumper, no good. Rebounded by Myers. And up ahead to Harmonoski. Harmonoski gets it over to Staffen. Long three, no good. And that is going to be West Hazleton ball with 15 seconds to go. See if they get on the board, Coach, to close the first quarter out on a positive note.
Correct.
Toro jogs the ball up the court, 14 seconds to go. Valley sitting in that 2-1-2 now. Toro gets it across. Nice shot.
Nice job.
By Santana. And that's the horn, and that's a big basket. Maybe they can build off the momentum.
It is. A good way to end the first quarter.
Valley 12, West Hazleton 2.
It's the end of the first quarter with the score. Valley 12, West Hazleton 2.
We're back here to Hazel area. Valley out to a 12-2 lead. Coach, story of the first quarter, paint points in the paint.
Absolutely. Any way you want to paint it, that's how the pictures come out. You know, West Hazleton, I don't know how they're going to do it, but they're going to have to try to manufacture more shot opportunities.
Yeah, they're going to have to weather the storm, as we said the first game with Maple Manor, and they did. Shaddy into the game, long shot there from Paige Harmon. And Toro back out to Beltre. Beltre takes a shot, no good. Ball batted around into the hands of Staffen. And over to Harmon. Harmon across the timeline. Over to Pavlik. Gia picks up her dribble. Pass inside on the block. And easy bucket right there as Martini got
Olivia
position.
Martini with the basket. She was fouled on the play.
Well, Taya, you know what I like about that? She got the entrance pass and she turned and went right up with it.
Yep.
No dribble.
Nope.
No hesitation.
Foul is on Amy.
So many times
Abreu.
You see a lot of these players that
Olivia
do that.
Shooting one.
Well, you see it even at the boys' level or the girls' level. A lot of times they'll take that extra dribble, put it on the floor, and then they'll get it blocked or whatever. But I'll
shot
tell you what,
good.
Martini, good-looking ball player. She knows how to play her position. And there is a turnover again. With 5:14 to go, it's 15-2. And Valley has a deep bench also, Coach.
That
I noticed that. They've been shuffling players in and out.
They have.
Martini back over to Pavlik. Pavlik with the left hand. Kicks it back over to Staffen. Nice pass down low. Back out to Alexis. Alexis lets it fly. That's a little long. And ran down there by Harmon. Harmon over to Staffen.
Yeah. Hand check on the floor.
Fouls on number 3, Ava Toro, her first.
Not too many fouls. Valley's only committed one as a team.
Well, West Hazleton, that's 5. And they don't want to get into a position where they're giving up one-on-ones. Pass down low, up, can't get it to fall. Ball batted around. Into the hands of Beltre. She's got a couple rebounds.
She does.
Someone needs to help her back there, and it's Toro. 15-2, 4:24 to go in intermission. And here comes the tie up there, and good defense there. I think that was Paige Harmon there that created the turnover, or created the jump ball. It will stay here with West Hazleton.
Entering the game for West Hazleton is Carolee Rodriguez and Amanda Capote.
Rodriguez and Capote in the
game. Valley.
Harmonowski is going to come
Kimberly
back in.
Hawkinson.
And Kimberly Hawkinson.
And Giada Pablo.
On the break, up a little too hard is Hawkinson, and it'll, I'm not sure what Chad said, he did the hokey pokey, did everything but turn himself around.
Yeah, I thought he said West Hazleton.
He did. He pointed one way and called blue.
Well, nice try by Valley to.
Well, he did point Valley's
he
way
did.
First. I'll let Chad off the hook. Beltre across the timeline, bounce pass over right wing. Staffen turns, gets the turnover. Hawkinson having a hard time controlling the ball, but it was tipped, and it will stay here with Valley with 3:40 to go, 13-point lead, and we have a timeout on the floor, 30-second timeout. Let's take a
West
quick
Hazleton
break.
West Hazleton takes a 30-second timeout.
Thank you.
entering the game for Valley, Yadriles Martinez.
All right, we're back to Hazel area. 3:40 to go in the half, 15-2. Valley looking to punch their ticket for a battle of the Valley. Valley drums, it could be, Coach.
Could be.
And that will be a big, big crowd expected here on Thursday night. Get your tickets early.
You know, I'll tell you, it's, you know, a day away yet, but I'm looking forward to it. I want to see
it. Nice bucket there by Shaddy.
Yeah, very easy. I'm just saying, it's really a neat thing for these
Lauren Shaddy with the basket. So.
Yeah, tomorrow we have a travel day, Coach, so we're off.
Yeah.
I was supposed to be at Chickalemme, but that's a story for another day.
Well, to pull one of your lines, I've heard that story, Paul Bo.
And I will give the response you give, NC, which is no comment. But we got Thursday night here, and should be a good one. And we got to look forward to districts coming up next week, and the girls, the boys. And good luck to the Hazel girls tomorrow as they're playing Lake Lehman for the Wiley Valley Conference. We'll be sure to ask Coach Gavio about that.
All right, and we saw Lake Lehman way, way back, remember, at the Christmas tournament here. They were one of the teams.
But we did not. Oh, yes, we did. Yeah, yep. You are right. Coach, you are right. You have that memory.
Thank you.
They played the first game.
They did. Against Abington Heights, if I'm correct.
You may be correct. I'm not sure. I don't remember that part of it, but it was way back when. I'll tell you what, though. I like Hazel's chances.
Goes with the Lady
Absolutely.
Wildcat.
And then in the nightcap game there, it'll be Redeemer against Pittston area. Two really good teams.
Oh, yes.
Back out to Toro, a little too hot to handle. She runs it down. Good hustle by Ava. Over to Beltre. Beltre leaves. Off the board. Can't get it to fall. Big rebound by Martini. Hauls the boards up ahead to Harmonoski. And Lauren's going to walk it up the court with 2:29 to go. This has been all Valley.
Yes.
Nice move by Harmonoski up and in.
Yeah, too easy.
That's Lauren Harmonoski with the bucket.
Yeah, West Hazleton's playing hard, but they're just, it's just not their night offensively at the moment.
And Valley clicking on all cylinders. Toro with a jumper that's no good. That was tiptoe. It will stay here with the Wildcats. And West Hazleton's not going to quit. Here comes Coach Gav. He's ready.
Coach Gavio making his way up. Steps. Always, both coaches have been great to interview this year. Coach Barletta, Coach Gavio.
Well, I'm letting you handle this one.
Very giving of their time.
You heard me, Coach. This is all you. Hawkinson. Right to the bucket, up and in. And unlike the Eagles we saw on Sunday, I don't think this Eagles team's going to blow the lead.
No, it's...
They are just clicking on all cylinders.
West Hazleton's, I mean, because of the pressure from Valley...
Yeah, the pressure defense.
They've not been able to even get into any kind of a pattern offensively to do anything.
Hawkinson weaves. Now back out, over to Harmon. Harmon backs it up, 1:19 to go on the clock. Right wing, Hawkinson, off the bank, no good. Rebound run down by, out to Toro. 1:09 to go. Toro weaving her way. Jumper from the foul line, hard, no good. And it will stay here with West Hazleton with 1:01 to go, 21-2.
Well, I think it's obvious. You can see the athletic ability with the young ladies that make up the Eagles team. They're quick. They run the floor well. And I'm really...
And they
I'm
jump
really,
the passing lanes just like that.
I'm really impressed with Martini. I mean, she gets the ball inside. She knows exactly what to do with it. She doesn't waste any time. I know I mentioned it earlier, but it's so impressive to see at this age somebody get the ball in the low post, turn and go right up with it. No wasted dribbles.
Nice shot. Mid-range jumper.
Boy, if all these girls are going to dump into Hazleton, The future looks bright, let me tell you.
Turnover again in the hands of Shaddy. 23-2. Last 25 seconds to go in a quarter as Harmon walks it up the court. Over to Hawkinson. She's played a nice game. Another mid-range jumper. She knocks down another one. Paige Harmon from both sides of the court.
Correct. Give her 4 points on the evening.
Two mid-range jumpers. Toro at the buzzer. That is no good. And we are at the half. Valley 25, West Hazleton 2. We'll take a quick break. We got a special guest coming up here. Coach Gavio in the booth when we return. All right, we're back here at Hazleton area. Valley leads 25-2 at the half, and we are here with Coach Gavio. He made his way up the steps. He said he likes the view of the booth.
And you guys, nice up here.
And you guys got a big game, Coach, coming up tomorrow, Wyoming Valley Conference, the league. You guys got in. You guys got a very tough Lake Lehman team coming. We talked a little bit off the air. Tell us a little bit about Lake Lehman.
Lake Lehman is they've won the league the league championship three of the last 4 years. They do a great job. Charlie Levan is a good friend of mine, and he's done a great job. Had a nice run and some nice players, and they're tough. They're really tough. They played another day. Everybody's known for something. You know, we like the press and stuff. He runs the best 2-3 defense around. He really does a good job with it. It's a little bit different what they do, and they got tremendous size. A couple of six-footers in there, so they're really, really long, very methodical, know what they want to do. They're in every game. They beat a very good Dunmore team. That's the number one seed, and they stay within 4 points of Prep. There's another good team up there. They won the division. Redeemer beat them in one game. Went to see that game. They're up 20-0. Me and my assistant coach, Dan Rogers, we went up to see the game, and I fell asleep on the lazy boy. I said, don't worry, we'll get there within a couple minutes. There was 4 minutes into the first quarter, they were up 20-0. So
Wow. That's
what it is. But and they're really, really good. Last year in the championship against the same Pittston team that's in their number one seed, and we know how good Pittston is. They've been excellent. They got three outside guards that are unbelievable.
Guard play. Yeah,
and they beat them like 35. It was hard getting a shot. So they're just a really good team, but we're looking forward to the challenge.
How are you guys health-wise coming into the game?
Health-wise, we're very good. We're as good as we've been. Had some good practices, and we're excited to be there. I bust some sports writers a little bit, and we have it on the bulletin board stuff that they picked as fifth in the inner division with Lacey Kringy, okay?
Wow.
We know we lost to one of our best players there. She's a great player and stuff, could have been a 1,000-point scorer, and we were really rolling. We were like 8 or 9-0, no one's coming close to us. And then we had a reboot starting the new year. And it took us a little bit, but we hung in there, and we've earned that right. We earned that right to get there to be a second team in Division One.
Yeah, and then coming into the district tournament next week, you guys have the number one seed.
Yeah, well, that's what happens. You keep playing hard, and you play a good exhibition schedule with those power ratings, and we beat a good Wilkes-Barre team. They fumbled down there, and you got to realize, you got to play the whole season, lost two or three games in a row, and our power points are good, so we'll be playing, I think, next Friday, or the 24th.
Right, Friday night,
A very good Williamsport team. Now, we played them really, really early, and
yep.
They had a new coach. They were just, it was their second game, and we jumped them out there. But it's a different team. Like I said, we don't have Lacey there. We've had some issues and stuff like that. A lot of injuries. Two ACLs, a mono, a car accident, and three twisted ankles. And we've hung in there. We played really, really hard. With a young team as we are, it's up and down. You don't know what you're going to get sometimes, but the kids are fired up, and we're looking forward to that game.
Yeah, and Williamsport, we covered a couple times last year. I did a couple of their games, and they're much like you guys. They have a younger team, new coaching staff down there, and I got some ins there, Coach, for you, Gavin. We'll take care of you there.
I'm going to say, they play a lot of the teams around here, and they're getting better. They're getting better. Dallas only beat them by like 5 points within two weeks ago. Crestwood beat them by like 3 points, and a really good North Schuylkill team is a good friend of me. Rich is, we talk about. He said, "Listen, they got some athletes, and they're pretty good, and they're getting better." Our press got to them a little bit and stuff, but that's going to be a tough game here.
Yeah, they're physical too. They like to bang around. The girls very like to physical. Bang around there. We saw them play Loyal Sock last year. We did the game down there at the Magic Dome down there.
Yep.
And they got a nice squad there, it's always nice to be. Now you can see Wilkes-Barre and Wyoming Valley West bang each other around and knocking somebody out.
I like it. I like
one
it a lot.
One win there, you guys got to win one game, you get back to the arena.
Yep.
I'd love to see you guys in the States this year.
We're looking forward. That's always been a goal since they've been going to the arena. I think there's only two teams, girls and boys, been there every year. Us and Abby, tonight's girls, who's a good friend of mine there, and we kind of say we want to get back there. Now we want to win it because we didn't show well the last year. The year before, and usually we played very well there, but we didn't shoot the ball well. We want to get back there. That's been a big goal of ours and stuff, and so they're looking forward to it. But one game at a time, we're in the Williams-Lake Conference playoffs, and we're excited to be there.
Yeah, absolutely, and hey, it's more practice for you guys to get to stay fresh there. You know, the boys are off for a little bit.
Yep.
They're going to be the two seed
there,
and they're going to play the winner of a play-in game down there. So, and the good part, Coach, I told him, the scouting report, I've seen all these teams play. I've covered just about all these teams all over. So I got the scouting report.
We'll make a phone call to you. We'll go out for a cheesesteak or something somewhere. Yep.
Absolutely.
Yep. So we're, like I said, we're excited. The kids are excited. We've had some good practices. And, once again, we expect to win. We expect to win, but it's going to be a tough game. We need to play well.
So, Coach, something me and Rich were talking about coming up in the thing here, just the young talent here on the court here. And I talked to Meadow Pavlik, and she was our player of the game. And I said, let me ask you, what grade are you? And she said, 8th. I said, where are you going to school? She said, Hazleton. I said, Coach Gav has a smile from ear to ear.
Listen to me. We are really young. I think you guys doing the game at one time, in a varsity game, we had 3 freshmen, 2 sophomores in the game. We have 1 senior, Grant Kane, who works her tail off, have a junior or 2 who do a great job and stuff like that. But make no mistake about it, our freshman team with 5, or I think there's 6 eighth graders on the team went undefeated. Our JVs lost 1 game in overtime that let's slip away. They're up 10 points in the fourth quarter. So you're talking fierce school. They're both undefeated. And we're having a great year. Won 16-6, and we're right there. So the future is really, really good for Lady Cougar basketball.
Yeah, we're really excited to be covering you guys, and hopefully next year is just as exciting. And I did get a lowdown on that eighth grade team. They said they're really, really good. Wait till you see that team coming up through the ranks.
I know them. They've come and we've seen them around. And Danny Rudge did a nice job at those
Danny's
kids. He's had them before COVID when they were real small. He'd asked me to come down to be playing the playground down there in Valley, inviting any kids who wanted to play and stuff like that. And they really love to play. And they're playing all over the place. And we have a lot of kids playing in the summer. A lot of kids. And I'm a believer in athletes and a lot of other sports and stuff. And they all play great other sports. They're softball players. They're playing all kinds of sports, volleyball, track and stuff. I like that. It's healthy.
Yeah.
And I think it's really good. And so I'm really excited about it.
Coach, you got to get a pair of red pants like Kiko has.
I like
those.
I think
you could rock the red
pants. He wears them a lot better than I do. I'll wear my pink shirts. That's what I said.
Is the patented pink shirt, Coach Gavin.
The patented pink shirt, baby. Real men wear pink.
Absolutely. Coach, anything? I didn't mean to take up all your time.
Don't worry. I like the microphone. Listen, I'm telling you, You know, I've been doing this a long time, but I like it up here.
Maybe it's we nice. Can, we got a great view.
You need a third guy for color and stuff. I can help you guys do that a lot.
Sure.
Very nice.
We're
going to
be covering
nice.
Some volleyball, they said.
You do a great job.
Thank
you really
you.
Do.
And you know, gummy bears
from,
up here.
From what I'm hearing from the people and stuff, they love it. You do a great job. The two of you work together. It's really nice. Professionally done. Professionally
Absolutely.
Done.
Thank you so much.
And, you know, to be honest with you, we always had tapes and stuff. And the advent of this, I like listening to it. Tapes
sure.
get me bored.
Yeah.
I want to hear things, and you don't have to figure out numbers. And you just have a keen insight into the game. You really do a great
Thank
job.
Thank you so much. That means a lot.
You definitely make our job easier. You know, Coach Barletta, the same way. You're always more than welcoming, you know, for anything I ask you before the game. You answer everything. Your young ladies are so well behaved, as are the boys that we've had up here. First things out of their mouths, they want to thank their teammates. It's never an I thing.
No.
It's a we thing. And listen, in this day and age, that just doesn't happen. That's
no,
being
no,
coached.
It doesn't happen. We use the word teamy, and once again, they're good kids. Come from good families, and they play hard, and they compete. And I always say, listen, a lot of good people, you got to compete. In life, you're always competing for everything. So you're competing for grades. You're competing for this. You're competing to get in colleges. Competing for everything. It's healthy. It's healthy. It really
is. And I loved your statement. You probably didn't see my thumbs up. But I think it's so healthy to hear a veteran coach as yourself say that you want to see kids involved in other things. Because I am so not specialization-oriented. I'm like you. Compete in as much as you can. The size of the school shouldn't matter.
Exactly. I say the same thing a lot of times. You can't teach pressure. You can do whatever you want. You got to be in the game. So if there's a kid in the volleyball game, and whether or not what their league, what their record is and stuff like that, and you're down to a final point, they'll feel that pressure.
Right.
You're in a softball game, and it's a close game, and the ball's hit you. You can't replicate that.
Right.
So I like kids who are in that situation, and it carries over in this sport because, you know, it comes down to sometimes last couple of minutes, couple of possessions and stuff, and they've been there. They get the feel of it. And like I said, stress, having some fun, and being part of a team. Being part of
a
team.
Agree.
And the most important part, Coach, you forgot to mention, your brother takes care of his parking. We get preferred parking.
Boy, I'll tell you what, I don't even get that.
He says, come on right in. He moves the cones for us.
Yeah, exactly, that's good. I see you take care of those guys. They make me sound good.
All right, Coach, thanks for coming up here.
Thanks. Hey,
good luck tomorrow
thanks
night.
Thanks for inviting me. This is nice up here. I like it, the catbird
right.
seat.
You're
Thank
always
you.
Welcome up here. We'll see you next week when you guys have your state game or
yep.
district game.
Very good.
Best of luck.
Thank you very much.
All
thank
right,
you, guys.
Coach,
doing a good job. Keep it up. Keep it up.
Tell the girls good luck on our behalf.
I will do that.
All right. Longtime coach, eighth area coach, Joe Gavio. My teacher back in D.A. Harmon. And he
All
still
right.
looks good.
Absolutely, and I love the way the man coaches. Totally, nothing but enthusiasm and energy.
Hey, I need a break from that coach. Let's go to break. We got about 3 minutes until the second half tip-off. We'll be back to Hazel area.
Students that are here, just a reminder, you should start calling for your rides home. Please start calling for rides home, the students that are here.
We're back here at Hazen area. We got, put your headphones on there, young man. Coach, we got two guests up here in the booth. This is just like open door policy today. We got Henry Mahalik up here, and we got Dominic Zazicki up here. Dominic is a student at Valley. All right, third grade student. Who's your teacher?
Miss Myers is his
homeroom. Miss Myers, okay. All right, well, we're going to get back to the game. If you want to listen, stay in and listen. And Valley, you should be happy here. Valley has a lead here, 25-2. And the ball over to Myers. Turnaround jumper is no good by Martinez. And here come the Wildcats. Toro, she just cannot get on track tonight, and that ball was tipped right into the hands of Beltre, lays it up and in.
Well, here we go. Never say never.
Harmonoski, bounce pass over to Martinez. Martinez, right wing. Now back over to Harmonoski. Bounce pass again. Martinez using the pivot foot, kicks it back out. Now back over to Hawkinson. Tell you what, Hawkinson played really well off the bench. And Valley is deep, I can tell you that, Coach.
Correct. We got Myers and Martini leading the Lady Eagles at 6 points apiece.
Both jockeying for our Hazen area player of the game, Coach.
Well, we've been known to have
two
on occasions. We had two last night.
We did. And you know what? The last night, Romeo, I forgot about this. He hit the go-ahead three-pointer.
Yes, he did.
And I have a thing, and he said he did it for the non-believers.
Oh.
That was my favorite quote of the night.
I thought so. I thought you were going to fall over the railing. I'll be honest.
They were so thrilled to be on, Coach.
Well, that's what it's about. Give them an opportunity to use their communication skills. And you got a kick.
Yep. Speaking of communication skills, now Chubby and Midge have moved the conversation, just so you know. It's no longer in the bleachers. And here comes Harmonoski across the timeline. Bounce pass over to Martinez again. Back out to Hawkinson. On the left wing, that is Myers. Myers drives. Hope she didn't roll her ankle there. There's a lot of feet got tangled up there. Martinez with the ball. Can't get it to fall. Shaddy swats at it, but into the hands of the Wildcats and up ahead to Beltre. Beltre's had a nice game tonight. She really has for West Hazleton. One of the bright spots, and that's going to be a jump ball. And it will stay here with...
Yeah, Maria literally had no one to pass it West to, and Hazleton. By that time, Valley pounced and forced another jump ball.
Pass there, Harmonoski just picks it off. And that will be a loose ball and out of bounds.
Yeah, off on Martinez's fingertips. Valley's been pretty decent tonight with their possessions. They don't want to start getting sloppy here in the second half as they head towards the championship game. Got a foul underneath. Some free throws coming up for the Wildcats.
Inevitably, Amy Abreu. At the line, first one up. High arcing is no good.
one too many bounces. It skips away from her. She retrieved it fairly quickly, and she'll reset and focus.
The rebound by Martinez. Taken away by Toro. Toro hard off the bank, up and in. The
banks are open late tonight for the Wildcats. It's good to see them getting a couple points here.
Good to see them get some rhythm in their offense.
They've played hard all night. All
yes, they have. Romanowski, baseline, off the side of the board. Van Valley just get every rebound there. Turn around by Myers, up and in.
Yeah, she just out physical underneath. Two underneath players for Valley have played exceptional basketball tonight, Myers and Martini. And an intercepted pass by Myers. We'll take the basketball the other way.
And across the timeline she goes. Left-handed dribble over to the right, long pass high over to Harmonowski. Now back to Martinez, back over to Myers. Myers drives. Well, she just shot put at that one, Coach.
She did.
But I'll tell you what, the power there, they just cannot stop her inside. Playing a fantastic game. She's been lights out tonight for this Valley team. Martinez, bounce pass back over to Harmonowski. Takes up her dribble, bounce pass over to Hawkinson. Hawkinson, bounce pass over to Myers. Myers, left-handed dribble, crossed over to the right. Bounce pass inside Martinez. Good pass by Harmonowski. Martinez gets herself a little too far under the basket, but rebounds it and puts it back in.
And she had to double bounce off the rim to put it in. Wonderful pass by Harmonowski. Almost a no-look pass.
Yes.
Pretty close to being a no-look pass. So well done by Lauren.
Three ball on the way by Beltre is no good.
And we have a slew of substitutes coming into the game for Valley. Pavlik in, Harmon in, and Martini back in for the game. As we are under 140 left.
And Pavlik with the ball. Over to Myers. Myers trying to get inside to Martini. And a mid-range jumper by Harmon misses this one. Nice rebound.
On the boards, we're going to have a foul going the other way. 29-6 with 1:15 left and counting. Well, 1:16, clock did not start. We're going to have a timeout. 30-second timeout.
Let's take a quick break, and we'll be back.
30-second timeout is taken by West Hazleton.
Welcome back. 1:12 to go in the third quarter. Valley by 23. Pavlik over to Harmon. And they're going to call it travel there. So for West Hazleton, Coach, down by 23 points, 6-minute quarters. There's a minute left to go in the third. Barring a miracle, we know they're probably not going to come back. So as a coach there, what do you look for now out of your team?
Compete. It's the one-word answer. I know it sounds simple, but you know, Coach Gavio talked about it. Listen, if every night were your night, you'd never lose, correct?
Absolutely.
So you have these nights where you don't play well and lose. You have nights where you play well and lose. But through it all, the common glue there should be the fact that you compete, regardless of what the status in the game is.
Myers. To Martini on the break. Can't get it to fall. Harmon turnaround jumper is just short off the rim. Final 20 seconds of the quarter and another jump ball.
Jump ball possession goes to Valley.
And you've seen Valley making a lot of substitutions right now.
Right, and they're doing the right thing, getting as many people in as they can. And why not? You've got a big lead.
Harmon no good there. And the ball on the line, and it'll be...
It's off of Martinez.
Yep, West Hazleton ball with 15 seconds to go.
But I think that's all any coach really should ask for is the fact that you continue to compete, don't quit.
I think 9 of the 10 players on Valley has played.
And that's a good thing because the game is out of hand point-wise. It's good to see no one's trying to embarrass anybody else.
No.
Scores. Get everybody in. Let them play.
Foul is on Mia Guzman-Beltre.
So the way it
for
looks
Valley
for
will be Idriles Martinez.
Thursday night, it'll be a battle of the Valleys.
It will.
In a nightcap. Valley against Drums. Always a huge rivalry. This place will be packed. And in the boys' game, it'll be Heights. Nice shot by Martinez.
First shot is up and good.
It'll be Heights taking on the Valley boys. So both Valley teams in the championship. No surprise there. There's your horn. Three quarters in the books.
That is the end of the third quarter, ladies and gentlemen. The score, Valley 30, West Hazleton 6. Once again, a reminder to all students, please call for your rides home.
As the public address... to Hazleton area 30-6. The Valley Eagles lead the West Hazleton Wildcats as we start the fourth quarter. Beltre with the ball. Rebound no good. And Hawkinson's gonna, and that should be Valley ball, and it will be. 5:44 to go. As I was saying before we went off the air, Coach, the PA announcer said, all students call for your rides home. You think they want them out of here?
Well, you want to make sure they get home safe, obviously, but it's just made you chuckle a little bit.
That made me laugh.
In the high school games.
Yeah. And that is going to be a jump ball. It'll stay here with Valley. Jumper by Staffen, no good.
It's run down by
Doug and Arrow.
And Arrow.
Yep, and now all 10 players have been in the game for Valley. As Gia checks in. Over to Shaddy. Shaddy back out to Harmon. Well, I'll tell you what, Coach, just looking ahead a little bit. I know we still got a quarter to go, but looking ahead to Thursday night, Heights and Valley should be a really good game with the boys. We saw how scrappy Heights was, and they fought and fought and fought, and they got three really good players on their team. And for the girls, and Drums and Valley, and I think Drums is going to want to run, and Valley's going to want to pound the ball inside. Should be interesting.
You're right. I'm looking forward to not only the games, obviously, but I'm looking forward to the atmosphere.
Oh, yeah.
I can do that now, but I'm no longer on the sidelines. You're so focused when you're coaching on
Foul is on Stephanie Santizo.
A lot of times you don't notice the crowd. You don't notice the atmosphere. So as a broadcaster, it's neat because you get to take everything in.
Yeah. Hawkinson back over to Staffen. Back out to Harmon. Valley running some clock here. 4:35 quickly to go in this ball game.
So I don't know what to do tomorrow night.
Well, I can tell you where I won't be tomorrow night if you really wanted to know. I'm not sure if I told you.
You did.
I will not be in Chickalemme for the PHAC. I don't know if I told you that, Coach.
He may have mentioned it.
But tomorrow, we have an off day, and then we have championship games Thursday, and then I will be in Williamsport Friday night for executive education coming to the Magic Dome as Williamsport gears up for their playoff run next week. So it should be a good one. Close out the week, and then next week, it's win or go home, Coach. Correct. Back to districts.
They'll be here back-to-back nights, correct?
Friday, Saturday.
Saturday. Yep. Friday for the girls, Saturday for the boys on opponents yet to be determined, correct?
Right. Coach Gav said they're playing Williamsport. Unless someone dropped out of the tournament, I'm not sure that is totally correct yet. There might be a play-in game since they are the number one seed, but we will see.
And it is, if it is the Millionaires, then so be it.
Yeah, they have a nice team and try young team just like Hazel area, and you know, very physical Williamsport as always. And you know, the boy in the boys' side of it, I think the Hazelton boys and the Williamsport boys are on a collision course for the arena. I really do. And that will be a game I'd love to see up there.
That was on Samantha Santino. Paige Harmon will be shooting two for
and
Valley.
Paige Harmon on the line. Shooting two. First one is no good.
Adrelas Martinez enters the game.
I'll
for
tell
Valley.
You what else I've really enjoyed. There's been no nonsense, no jawing, no pushing and shoving from any of these teams for two nights. And they've played hard. They've gone at it.
Yeah.
Again, that stuff's coached.
Ava Toro up and fouled. She will shoot two.
Boy, that official looks familiar for some reason. Do you recognize that official?
I do not.
The call?
Nope.
You don't?
Nope.
You sure he wasn't up here yesterday?
I don't know who he is. First one is no good.
Now you're positive of that.
I'm positive.
Okay. Boy, it must be my eyes. He looks awful familiar to me. I'm almost positive I was sent a photo with you and that said person in it as well.
Photoshopped.
Oh, okay.
You're drinking the milk from forgetful cows. That's what happened.
Paul Bowen, total denial, ladies and gentlemen, who's listening at home.
Malik, oh, a little short.
That looked good.
Yeah, she had a good look at the basket.
Goes Beltre on a run.
Yeah, Beltre's had a nice game.
Pulls up. They're going to get her for a travel.
3 minutes and 20 seconds to go in the ball game. Valley's controlled at 12-2 after one quarter, 25-2 at the half, and they've just been in total control of this one. Martinez from the corner. No good. Shaddy throws it back up. Can't get it to fall.
Trey hunts it down.
Minutes and 32 seconds to go.
Yeah.
as coach, as we were saying before, I mean, Valley just set the tone early. They went right to work down low. I think the first six buckets they had were all in the paint.
They were, and they jumped out to that 10-point lead in the first quarter. Shut West Hazleton out in the second quarter, had a commanding 25-2 lead at the half, and it's
And that's
no looking back.
That's big, and like I said, if you can, especially 7th and 8th grade basketball, if you have players that can play under the basket, that is a huge, good shot by Toro. Give her four for tonight.
Rebound underneath.
Yep, rebound by Shaddy. 1:45 to go. And we got another jump ball. How many jump balls have been there tonight, Coach?
33.
What was the over and under?
28.
A lot of jump balls.
A lot of tie-ups.
Yep. .133 to go. Beltre still fighting hard.
And that's what we talked about. And that's good to see. They're still competing.
And we sent Damian down. He's going to get our player of the game.
That's very nice of him to do that. Appreciate that.
Christian bailed on us. That's what happened. Martinez turnaround. Rebound by Doganero. Toro still playing hard. Another turnover. Even can't get it to fall. Under a minute to play, Coach.
Correct.
Beltre.
Almost.
Jumper no good. Toro for three and she's fouled.
And she will go to the line. And I'll tell you, like you said, they're still competing here.
Yep.
And that's you know, it's all you can ask for. Have you unveiled who's coming up to visit?
Not yet.
Okay. You want to keep them in suspense?
We will
for the
keep.
Last
we're trying to keep our audience here.
49.3.
We might have to bring Freddie up to keep the audience next. We had Coach Gavio, Kevin Yerkanen. We had Sarge. We had Chad Obert, the guy that's down there now.
I'm not familiar
blowing
with
the whistle.
Who you're talking about. I'm sorry. I don't.
Who are we going to have Thursday up here?
I don't know.
To see if we're going to get up in the booth here Thursday for two games for interviews.
Somebody.
Maybe we'll get Billy if he's up here. I'd like to get Chubby up here, but he won't walk up here. I know that.
And
we're
not
delivering.
Carrying him.
This isn't Domino's. We're not delivering down there. Into the hands of Pavlik. And she lost it. It'll be West Hazleton ball. Look at that producer we have down there, Bobby. He's down there telling the coach, everywhere, telling him who's the player of the game. No, we just need him to start counting me in, and that's it. He'll be a professional producer. 36 seconds to go. Ball tipped around. In the hands of DeVille. I think that was that number one? No, four.
No.
That was Garnett. Back over to Toro. She's been busy. Can't get it to fall. 18 seconds. Up ahead to Pavlik. Pavlik's going to probably know. They're gonna, Beltre's still playing.
She's still going at it, man. She's not.
I think they called backcourt there.
They did, I believe. It happened very quickly.
Yep.
So this should do it, right?
Yep. Hawkinson's probably going to dribble it out here. Well, they're right on there. Garnett's right on her. Over to Martinez. 10 seconds to go. Inside, and Doug and Arrow doesn't get the shot in. And 3 seconds. There's your horn, Coach.
That'll do it. It's a wrap. So two nights of playoff basketball.
Yep.
At the middle school level.
So our player of the game is going to be Leah Myers.
Oh, it's revealed.
8 points. Set the tone early. Inside her presence.
Yeah, 1-2 inside punch with her.
And Martini, yep.
And Martini, yep.
And we'll get Lee up here on broadcast row, as we call it.
You have a different name for it every week.
Well, this is the... And Lee is coming up. Our producer's getting her to come up. We'll get her all...
See some of the Wild Cougar boys, players leaving.
They came over again to check on us if we needed food.
They do. They're great kids. I'll tell you, they really are. They really, really, really are. Wish them nothing but the best. And so looking forward to what we have left. It's really been an honor to get a chance to do this, and can't wait for the game on Thursday.
Yeah.
Here we go. We've got Leah on her way up.
The young lady.
Hi.
There you go, kiddo.
All right. Don't forget, we got to get someone else to take a picture of us now because Christian isn't here. So we got to get our picture for the player of the game. But our player of the game, number 24, is it Leah or Lee?
Leah.
Leah. Okay. Leah Myers, 8 points. You set the trend there to start the game, getting those points in the paint there. They never recovered. Oh, Damien's going to take our photo here. Okay, let's get our picture first.
We're going to do the photo first.
Yeah,
now.
We'll do the photo.
Let's just do it this way since you're over there.
All right, we're going to get a picture first here.
We're going to face this way, young lady.
Well, I think it doesn't reach that far. All right.
All right.
3, 2,
there
we go. I got a bunch.
All right. Excellent. Now we got the important questions.
All right.
All right.
So, did you guys see a weakness there that you guys knew that you guys could take them inside?
Yes, we did. I think we didn't come into this game and, like, underestimate them. I think we came into this game just confident, and we pulled through.
Well, gee, 16-0, you must have been pretty confident. But you know what, Leah? First of all, congratulations.
Thank
but
you. Thank you.
It didn't take very long for you guys to establish your dominance, particularly inside.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we're just a very strong built team, and I think a lot of us have experience with AAU. So
right.
I think the experience definitely helped us the most.
Now you're in eighth grade?
Yes.
And where are you going next year?
High school.
Coach Gav is smiling from here to here.
Smiling? He should be doing backflips. Man, I'll tell you what.
Yes.
Wow. So, good for you.
Thank you.
Yes. So now you and Olivia inside were dominant tonight. 14 points out of the 30 points. But let's be honest, you guys let off the gas in the fourth quarter.
Yes.
You know, everybody got to play all 10 players, which is always good to see, getting everybody into the game.
Yeah.
Thursday night, the big game against Drums. I know it's a rivalry. It mm-hmm. always is a rivalry.
Yeah.
How did the games go during the season? Obviously, you guys won both of them.
Yes. They're definitely a very good team. They were very good competition for us. I think we just outran them. I think our talent definitely took over. But they're definitely great competition for us.
Yeah, they got 3 good guards on the team. They got Meadow inside, so they got some height on the team.
Yes.
But you guys, the way you guys are getting the ball inside, I think that's the way probably Thursday night we're going to see the game go down to start the game off.
Yes.
Well, I know we've talked a lot about how your inside game was tremendous tonight. But if you go back and watch this, I don't think Wes Hazleton had a shot attempt for the first 3 or 4 minutes of the game. Your defense was stifling as well.
Yes. Yeah, our defense is very strong. We definitely try to shut them down outside of the paint and then work our way in.
Yeah, I mean, you guys came out. I saw you guys. You switched the zone. You went a little bit man, but zone, it was one and done.
Yeah.
I mean, you and Olivia just dominated on the boards. And even Lauren, when she came into the game underneath there, and in the two nights tonight here with all 4 teams, I haven't seen anybody that could dominate the boards like you guys can.
Thank you.
This will be a good one on Thursday.
Yeah, it'll be
a good one. Can't wait to see both of them.
Yep.
So, well, we're going to let you go rejoin your teammates.
All right, thank you.
And congratulations for being our player of the game. We'll give you a lucky gummy bear. Take a lucky gummy bear. Take a red one because Chris Catrone scored 20 after he had a red gummy bear.
All right.
Get a red gummy bear. Looking Thursday night. You better score 20. We'll have you back up here.
I got it.
All right, she got it. She got the red gummy bear. That's the good luck, Bobby.
Yep.
Catrone's going to hit 20 when he got that. Thank you, Leah, for coming. Best of luck Thursday
night.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, Leah. Have a wonderful night. We'll see you on Thursday. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yep.
All right. Another well-spoken young lady, and they're ready for Thursday night. Coach, we're ready for Thursday night.
We are.
Little Thursday night basketball, and I got her. I turned it off there. Yep. We got it off there. But she gets to go rejoin her teammates, and dominating performance by Valley. Let's call it what it was. I mean,
yeah, it was. And, you know, you appreciate the fact that West Hazleton played as hard as they did. But how many of these student athletes, and again, being an educator for 34 years, it is just so refreshing to hear these young people speak, how well-spoken they are. I mean, eye contact. You're not getting 8 million ums, likes, okays. They're not fidgeting. They give credit to their teammates. And you know what? People, you know, that's a credit. It's a credit to the teachers teaching them, their coaches coaching them, and their parents parenting to them. And it's refreshing because, believe me, when you've spent a long time in it, as I have, you hear quite a lot of negativity about the youth. And I got to tell you, these are top-notch kids, everyone we've had up here.
Yeah, absolutely, and I really like the part of the broadcast. It's one of my favorite parts of it because it's giving today's athletes. I mean, everybody can listen to the game on YouTube. Whether you like us, whether you don't like us, is totally irrelevant. We're here for the kids. We're here to provide the game and provide a little bit of fun and call the game like we see it. But to get these kids up here and have them talk after the game and speak in the manner that they're very well spoken.
Very well spoken.
And it's always my teammates. I knew we, like I said, it was the Mark Mussina we. We did this. We did this. It's never I. And that is definitely.
Well, I got to tell you, there's one person in this gym tonight that's going home that should be smiling with every tooth visible from ear to ear. And that's Coach Gavio, because there are some dandies coming up in this program.
Yeah, there are. All right, let's do our thank yous. We'll just talk about Thursday's game briefly, and we'll get out of here. I'm going to thank Christian, who, even though he bailed on us on stats for the second game, did a great job on the first game. Thanks to Damien, our producer. He is the producer of the year. He ran down there. Damien, you look so professional, squatting down behind the bench. Bobby Mahalik and his young boy over here.
Henry. Did a nice job.
Did a great job
helping
there
us out.
In. Were you pushing the buttons? Yeah, you were. You were turning me off. Nobody wanted to hear me, right? For my partner, Rich Zalonis, I'm Paul Bowe. Let's talk one little quick, Coach.
Holy cats, you call me by my first name. I almost fell over.
I always say Rich when we're going away. Chad's coming back on the thing. We're giving him the thumbs down. All right, hey, so Thursday night we got the boys to start it off at 6 o'clock. Get here early. Get a good seat. It's going to be Valley and Heights Terrace.
Mm, that's going to be good.
And then in the nightcap, we have the girls. We have Drums and Valley, a huge rivalry. That's going to be a good one, too. So, on behalf of everyone here at Hazleton Area and my partner, the coach, Rich Zalonis, I'm Paul Bowe. Have a great night, and we'll see you Thursday. Tally-ho, everyone.